Welcome everybody to a Tilt webinar with Sarah Bell, learning in and out of lockdown, our journey through the pandemic. And Sarah in particular said that some of you might not know her as Sarah, but rather as InfoCAD, and I've got the MFL, but it's actually been changed now to ML. And we are Saturday the 10th of April, 3:30 to 4:30, but as so well spotted by Joe, it is not GMT. We are now into summer. We're into summertime. I'm Helen Myers. I'm chair of the London branch of the Association for Language Learning. We always thank Heike Philp and Linguascope who help us to set up these webinars, which have now been going on for over a year. Well, actually, they've been going on since 2011, but there've been loads over the last year. But here I want to introduce you to Joe Dale, who's been the person who's collected all of this wonderful talent that we've seen over the last year. Over to you, Joe.
Thanks, Helen. So it's really lovely to be here, as always, on a Saturday afternoon this time for the latest Tilt webinar. We're in for a real treat this afternoon, so I can't wait to introduce Sarah. But a little bit about me, first of all. I am an independent language consultant. I have to make a living through webinars exclusively now, although I have started a bit of a sideline in podcast editing, which I'm really, really enjoying as well. But in the chat, I have put a link to a Google Doc, which has 18 example sessions, lots of different ideas that you can have a look at in relation to hybrid and remote teaching contexts and different tools that you can use in order to promote language learning in those different contexts. And if there's anything you would like bespoke, I can design something for you as well. Just get in touch. I'm very easy to contact. And back to Helen, enough of the plug there.
Thank you. And I'm just looking there at the chat. It's really lovely to see that you're introducing yourselves as well. So please do carry on doing that. Thank you, Joe, for all you're doing. Member of ALL, are you a member? Please use the opportunity now to put in the chat if you're a member of the Association for Language Learning, because that's the association which is behind the running of this, I suppose, in that as a London branch, we've got a Zoom account and that's what we're using. If you're a member, please do let people know and say, do join. And all the webinars that we've had, you can find on the ALL London website. There's a link. Joe puts them onto his YouTube channel. And on the site, we've got the link to that, but also the chat and photos and that sort of thing. So we've got things coming up. So Thursday coming up. So that's wrong. It's not GMT, it's BST. I must change all of these afterwards. 8 o'clock, come along in here. Ellie Chettle-Cully, who's just brilliant on particularly on primary and SEN, but it's very, very relevant to everybody. So that'd be great. Those of you who are members of ALL, please do come to webinar 2 on Thursday, the 22nd of April, when we'll be conducting polls to find out what people feel about the proposals for the GCSE subject content. Probably afterwards, the webinar and the resources will be free for anybody to view, but it's just during that webinar, that's when we're conducting the survey. So please, please do come along to that. We've got Royce Fryer, who's coming along on Saturday, the 24th of April, and also booked in even as far as May. And I know that Joe has got some very exciting other people as well that he's booking in soon. So we'll be hearing about that another time. As I said, everything is on the webinar page, but you are here to see Sarah. As Joe introduces her, I really recommend that you do look through all of her. This is really what Sarah's written about herself. She's probably talking about it as well, but I think it's really fascinating to read all the things that she's been doing. So over to Joe.
No problem. So Sarah, I've met a couple of times face to face when I've been up to Scotland. Sarah also very kindly came to one of the events at Southampton University, the ILILC conference as well, which I think she found really useful. And what I particularly like about what Sarah does is the way that she shares lots and lots of different ideas, like practical ideas of what she's doing in the classroom. And I think my understanding is tonight we're going to see lots and lots of different practical ways. It might be that, you know about the tools already, but that doesn't matter. What matters here is about Sarah's context and her journey and how she's adjusted to life under lockdown and in the pandemic based on her context, which I think is absolutely fascinating. So thanks everyone for coming along. Do ask questions in the chat. We'll do the questions at the end, unless you can't see the screen or that sort of thing, but we'll do all the questions at the end. But thank you so much, Sarah, for this webinar. And we're really looking forward to hearing all about how you've been using technology at your school near Glasgow. Over to you, Sarah.
Okay, well, Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for giving up some of your time this afternoon to join me on this wee presentation. So hopefully I'm sharing my screen and hopefully you can see a little PowerPoint, a little starter. So what we have here is obviously my contact details. I do have a personal Twitter account, but I don't tend to use it. So InvercadML is a departmental one, so I don't put personal posts on. I do tend to keep it to school or education related posts. It is open for all the members of the department to post. It tends to be me. I'm a bit of an addict, you'll see in a little bit. I've put my weight clip details on here and I'm going to come back to that shortly as well. Please do ask questions as we go along if you have any. You might have had a chance to skim over the information that was up at the screen before, a little bit about me. So I'm a principal teacher in Green at Inverclyde Academy in the west of Scotland. I've been a principal teacher, which is head of department, since 2013. You'll have gathered from the accent that I'm not native to Greenock or Scotland, so we moved up here in 2005. I actually did my teacher training in Manchester. First post was in Nuneaton in a very small school, just 400 pupils, school in special measures, so a bit of a baptism of fire, but a really good grounding, finding my feet as a teacher. Whilst I was on maternity leave, we relocated up to Scotland. When the time was right, I then went back into teaching. I did a number of years of supply for various schools, and that again was actually really helpful for me. Different schools, private schools, I did a couple of stints in private schools, public school, state schools, smaller schools, bigger schools, denominational, so in the west of Scotland tends to be Catholic schools, and then I've finally found my feet at Inverclyde Academy in the west of Scotland in Greenock. I love learning about learning, as it said in the little bio that was up at the start. I love sharing practice, love talking about teaching. I really, and people say, what would you do if you weren't a teacher? It's like, don't really know. So I think learning about teaching, finding and sharing ideas, it keeps my teaching alive. It just every day brings something new. This quote came on Twitter. It's actually just this morning. So yes, learning from mistakes, certainly this past year, goodness me, we have all learned from mistakes. We've all tried new things, and absolutely being a lifelong learner makes you a better teacher. So a little bit of the context of the school Joe mentioned. That's a picture of my lovely school, Inverclyde Academy, school badge, a little bit emojis of the department. So if you, Scotland's actually massive when you look at it. So Glasgow here, I actually live just 6 miles north of Glasgow city centre. I drive north a little bit over the Erskine Bridge every single morning, up the M8, you get to the end of the M8 and you get to Greenock. It's a fabulous commute. So on the right hand side, I'm driving up and I have Dumbarton Rock, Dumbarton Castle, Ben Lomond in the distance, the River Clyde, sometimes great big boats going up and down. It's just, it's a lovely start to my day. Unless it's a typical Scottish day when it's dark and rainy and you can't see a flipping thing, but no, it's a lovely start to the day. Greenock itself is actually the most deprived area in Scotland. So when we think about context, it does have a part to play in what I teach and how I teach. So the school has 800 pupils. It was a merger of two schools probably about 13 years ago now, and it has a very unusual catchment area, a very unusual shape, the result of which is that 65% of our pupils live in what in Scotland we call SIMD 1 to 3, so it's the poorest 30% of the data zones in Scotland. Data zones are kind of postcode areas. So 65% of our pupils, two-thirds of the school population, live in the poorest 30% of the postcodes in Scotland. And that, obviously you can't broad brush, you can't generalise, it does have an impact on the nature of our school, the priorities of our school, especially even more so it's accentuated it during lockdown. Our school motto is work hard, aim high and achieve your potential. And we certainly in the department, certainly me and my classes, absolutely high expectations, high aspirations for our pupils. And we do all that we can to give them the life experiences that maybe certainly probably my own children take for granted. And I use Twitter again so much partly because of that, is to celebrate everything that they achieve and everything that they do, to promote languages, to really build this positive vibe about languages. I'm sure it's quite similar, a lot of schools and a lot of areas, you have to fight your corner. And languages, I think, more so than an awful lot of subjects, flood Twitter with good news stories. You know, the head teacher knows that she can rely on the languages department. It's a constant flood of good news, of good practice, of new things, of innovation, of positivity, even if it doesn't always feel like that. We get involved in lots of initiatives. So long before DYW, which is developing the young workforce in Scotland, long before that was a thing, we had language ambassadors from Strathclyde University, that students would come in and speak to our pupils. We'd invite local employees and employers in, literally not being local to the area. I would sit with the Yellow Pages and go through and just ring, you know, cold call companies saying, do you have anybody who speaks a language? Do you want to come and talk to the school? And you know, every opportunity as a head of department, you have to fight. And keep bums on seats, keep that motivation, keep that drive. In our school, we teach French and Spanish. It's a department of 2.6, so there's two full-time members of staff and a colleague who works 3 days. We're all dual qualified, so the pupils come to us in S1, which is year seven. They've had a range of experiences of French from their primary schools. Being aware of that, we actually start all pupils with Spanish. So we do the first up to Christmas in Spanish, and then in January we switch to French, and then in second year they do the first term in French, and then they switch back to Spanish. Then they make their option choices for third year, so year nine, and they choose either French or Spanish, or they can do both. And then languages are out of core, and then they have the choice to continue or not with languages. So that's how our basic structure, and it works for us. So I'm very honoured to have been contacted by Joe a couple of months ago and invited to present so many fantastic presentations. Just setting again where we are and kind of the tone for the little presentation this afternoon. So looking back, our priorities at the start of 2019-20, so before any of this started, can you remember back that far? In Scotland, again, there's been a push to close the gap, close the attainment gap, or narrow the attainment gap. So as a school and departments, we were very much looking at, well, what is our gap? It's about knowing your context, knowing your story. And in our department, we found that although pupils were not too bad at the reading and the listening aspects of learning a language, they struggled with talking and writing. They couldn't really get that extra level of detail, the accuracy, the confidence. You know, many of them struggle with the confidence in, you know, English presentations or presentations in English or in English as a subject. So we really had to boost their resilience and their self-confidence in their talking and their writing. We'd also been looking into, bear in mind this is going back a couple of years now, various metacognitive strategies, so retrieval grids, which are now part and parcel of pretty much every lesson we teach, the format of learner conversations, coaching wheels, which is something that I'll demonstrate a bit later on, and digital creativity. So rather than just plugging yourselves into a computer and using a website, but actually how could they use digital creativity themselves? And in fact, one of the first things I did when I was appointed as head of department was invite Joe up to come and do some training with the department a long time ago now. Still got the same ancient, unreliable, non-functioning computers in the department. So again, that's one of the challenges that we face. But how do we take the digital technology, the digital schools, the tools, and the digital skills that they're going to need in the future, and how do we use them in the languages classroom? So just before lockdown of last year, we'd had a couple of successful projects, Mad Mags, which is an online digital magazine, like a collaborative writing tool that worked very well. We did something on healthy lifestyle with our third years, and we also did a very successful stop motion video project, animation project with our second years, and they were really positive. The pupils got a lot from that. It's not what I'm going to talk about today, mind. So then our priorities for this year have been blended learning, not knowing what was heading our way, but knowing that we needed to get to grips with teams. So this time last year, when we first went into lockdown, as a department, we weren't particularly familiar with teams. As a school, we hadn't really been using teams. We'd been using Show My Homework just for last year, but we hadn't been using teams. Microsoft quizzes, we needed to make them meaningful, vary the type of questions, scaffold them, make sure that there is that element of starting with low stakes questions and then building up the complexity, maybe bringing in branching. HWB is health and wellbeing, and that runs through this. It's a real focus for our school with the catchment that we have, the nature of the pupils that we have, that actually looking after the health and wellbeing, checking in with the pupils is very important. And we do that through the quizzes, which I will mention later on. We were also just dipping a toe in the water with the extensive EPI approach, the extensive processing instruction, the kind of quantifying, but not going in for it full scale. We just wanted to see, well, is it something that would work for us? You know, we're a small department, so there needs to be consistency across the teachers, not in exactly what we do and how we do it, but in a small department, you do need to have some kind of consistency of approach. Looking forwards again, where are we heading now? We know that we need to make better use of class note, but we've been a bit late to the party with this one, and we are going to go ahead with the EPI approach. So first wee thing, and this is where I've got fingers, everything crossed, that the technology is going to work. Instead of happiness, maybe job satisfaction. So again, I remember seeing some of the early TILT webinars and the ALL webinars and other ones and thinking, oh, if only we all had digital, if only we had digital styluses, if only all our pupils had this. And actually, I think you just have to recognize and work within the context that you're in. There's a lot of good and a lot of positive about my department and how we're structured. So first we little play, Mentimeter. Okay, so I have everything crossed for this. I'd like you to think about these two questions. It will come up as anonymous, so please don't feel that if there is something that you're about to share that everybody's about to know, oh, it's who said what. If you're not sure of how Mentimeter works, you've got a couple of ways of getting into this. So you can literally go to menti.com and type in the number. I'm hoping the QR code works. It works when I scan it from home. Or you can put in the URL here. And there are two questions. You should have two slides. It will allow you to put in three answers. So what challenges do you face in your context? Now, this might be actually on a personal level, at a departmental level, or a whole school level. It might be that, you know, there are personality clashes in your department. You might be the head of department, you might be a class teacher, you might be somebody else within the department. It might be that you've got a really unsupportive head teacher. It might be staff absence. So what are the challenges that you face in your context? On the flip side of that is, what do you appreciate about your context? So I've said that I'm in a small department. Now, that does bring challenges, especially we've had staff absence, which means that more falls to the remaining members of staff and maybe some things have to be put to one side. But I actually like being in a small department because there are a few of us to have personality clashes. We actually work very well as a unit. So if you wouldn't mind, and I can't see people's, obviously everyone's not on camera, over the next couple of minutes, I'm just going to talk a tiny bit again about some of the other challenges and things that I appreciate about my context. If you wouldn't mind just filling in the Mentimeter, and then I will show on the screen. And again, this is one of the tools. I've only used it a couple of times with classes in live lessons. There's a whole range of ways that it can be used. And I know that it's featured in either actually as part of people's presentations, or there have actually been webinars that are featured on how to use it. So this will produce, hopefully, fingers crossed, a word cloud. So hopefully you can get into that. I'm actually just going to go off this and go to, everything's in the way on my screen. Okay. So I can see 12 people have answered this first one. So down here, there are just the two slides because I'm using the free version. It keeps a count of who's answered. Now I've hidden the answers, but behind this picture of the challenges, will be a word cloud. If people put the same word, it'll become, you know, more focused, it'll become a bigger image. And again, behind this one as well. So you should be able to move on to the second slide. Down at the bottom, there should be a little arrow and you can move on to the second slide when you've input. I think it's a limit of 25 characters. So I'll reveal the images in a minute and you can continue, it stays open for a wee while. So the challenges that, well, I see as challenges, but you might think, well, hang on, what's she talking about? I would love to have that. You know, that would work for me. So I've said a small department, When I was appointed, there were five members of staff, but we've got a falling school roll and there've had to be staff cuts across. So it's that kind of natural wastage as people have retired, colleagues have retired, they've not been replaced. Languages also came out of core a few years ago now, just not long after I was appointed. Unfortunately, in the department, we have been hit by significant staff absence. Over the last 5 or 6 years, different members of staff have had extended staff absence. And that has undeniably had an effect, both in terms of workload for the teachers, but also in terms of the timetable for the pupils. In some cases, we've had to amend their timetable, reduce the amount of language content, modify, and just accept that they're not going to get the full experience that we would like. And again, that's a kind of a shift in mindset that sometimes you have to get used to. I've mentioned that I teach in an area of deprivation. We have a higher proportion of harder to reach pupils, pupils who've experienced adverse childhood experiences, low levels of literacy. As a result, we have wide ranges of ability in our classrooms. So most of us, many of us will probably teach in mixed ability classes, but we do have a very wide differential in each of our classes. We have a high proportion of pupils who do have significant barriers to their literacy levels. In addition, we face challenges with social skills. So as much as anything, we're actually educating our pupils in how to interact with each other. And again, I know that's not unique to my particular context. Again, languages are out of core. We have a very supportive SLT, a senior leadership team, but we do struggle with the uptake or the perception of languages. It's perceived as being difficult. Many pupils in our school prefer more vocational subjects. And I've mentioned, although we do have computers in the classroom, you're very fortunate to have the computers. They are really very, very old. They're very, very unreliable. They're very, very slow. And yeah, it's a challenge, shall we say. However, the positives, I'm going to reveal these word clouds in a minute. I've mentioned my senior leadership team. They are very supportive. They know what we do in the department in terms of teaching and learning and supporting our pupils. They recognise the challenges that we face, so that they're always very supportive of new ideas, of if I approach for additional funding. We have significant autonomy in the department. So although, as I've mentioned, that we try to have some consistency in a broad terms of approach, each member of staff actually delivers that in their own way. We're well resourced and we're a small team, but we do work together. We've worked together for a few years, so we know how each other works. So let's have a little look at what's behind. So what are the challenges that people are facing, hopefully? Ooh, okay, so quite a few people. So it should be the biggest words are the ones that most people have put. So actually the challenges people are seeing is that personality clashes in a large department. So this is something that I'm very well aware of. No subject for PT, that certainly in Scotland, I don't know about in England so much. If there's mergers of departments, so languages quite often gets taken over by English, so you don't actually have a subject PT, yet staff absence is up there, pushy parents. So again, this is the flip side. I've worked in private schools, absolutely get that. Whereas maybe we've got disengaged parents, pushy parents, tiger parents can be just as bad, outdated curriculum. There's some really interesting ones. So what I'll do is that I will, as this, because people can keep adding to this, it stays open for another couple of days. So I will keep it open and I'll share that later on and say it's all anonymous. And then the things that we appreciate about our departments and our context, absolutely. So support from SLT, that's one of the ones that I'd put in, a small department, colleagues, yes. Improving uptake, good. So some positive stories, supportive departments, support features in a lot of these. Fantastic students, yet support, it keeps coming out, support, support, support. Students in general, yeah, oh, great IT support, I'm envious. Oh, that's all changed around again. So Mentimeter, just a wee taster as to how you might want to use Mentimeter in a lesson. So I've used it in live lessons. Okay, so hopefully I'm back to my little presentation. So I'm going to be revisiting online and in-class tools and approaches. There's two walkthroughs I'm going to do, one of a learning app tool and either one or two flipperties. I am trying to keep an eye on time. I did enjoy the opportunity when Joe contacted me and invited me to give a presentation. I actually went back over my tweets over the last year And so this actually was posted in 2016, and it's quite a nice cartoon. It goes on, there's one more on the left and one on the right, and I am a total Twitter addict. But honestly, I have learned so much from Twitter as a CPD tool, and of people sharing and giving advice and suggestions and sharing resources. It's been utterly fabulous. When Joe contacted me, I said, oh, but I've got nothing to share, Joe. Everything I do, and this was a year ago, 28th of June, total magpie. So yeah, it's not very much that's original here. I think there's a couple of new things maybe later on. And I have said that I try to credit the original post or poster in my tweets, and again today, but it can be hard to keep track of. And in fact, somebody put on Twitter a couple of days ago, how do you keep on top of all the tweets and things you want to say? So Wakelet might be your answer. So on my first slide, I had a slide which had my Wakelet contact details. So if I, everything's blocking its way, Wakelet is here. So this is my homepage on Wakelet. Now I started using Wakelet about a year ago. I have two accounts. I have one that's a school account, and then I have one that's a personal account. So I'm actually, I teach yoga in my spare time as well. So it's various yoga resources. And so this is the kind of landing page, if you like. Just in the last couple of weeks, I've organized it a bit more and started using what are called sections, just to make it a little bit tidier. You'll see that there is something here called a Tilt webinar resources. So what I've started doing, I haven't quite finished it yet. This is a collection of the various resources and links and exemplars of my collections that I'll be referring to in the next 30, 40 minutes or so. There are also links to various apps with things that I've created. The learning apps has walkthrough videos as well. In particular, when we're thinking about how do we collate tweets and so on, this is how easy it is. So this is where I just literally post any tweets. I just stick them in here, and then I can just refer to them, and I've not got to worry about forgetting who it was who originally posted it. It's all kinds of things, hiding things. So how easy is it to do? Very easy. If you haven't come across Wakelet before, it's free. I generally only do free things. So create a new collection, call it what you want to. I'm just going to call it tweets. Add a cover image. You can use your own, or you can add one from the library. So I, so I meant to type Twitter. Right, we'll have that one. Okay, so we've got that. It's got his name on it. Never mind, it's going to be a temporary one. I can write in here what the description is. And then you'll see, hopefully on my screen, I've got the Wakelet extension. So if I go to, I've got all these things covering the top of my screen. If I go to, I've got Twitter open. This was a problem. I actually had this before, so I knew this would happen. Me doing something alone, this is just tweeted just an hour ago. You know, that flipping great boat that got stuck, and then when someone's watching. So this is my fear for this afternoon, is that although it all works fine when I'm doing it by myself, what I actually wanted was ALL. So I've got the Wakelet extension. It's just a free extension in Chrome. If I wanted to bookmark ALL or a specific tweet, I literally just click on that. Wakelet will then ask me, where do I want to save it? So I'm now scrolling down, it saves them alphabetically. I've got my tweets, it saved it in there. Now what I could do is I can edit how it looks. So if you saw, we go back into it again, I can edit this and just have Twitter. I could put a description. Or if I go into my Wakelet, and I go into my tweets. Oh. Where is it put my tweets? How can I've lost my, there you go. What do I say about that big boat? Grr.
Just don't think we're watching you, all right? And you're on your own.
Don't, I'll be tempted to go make a cup of tea. So you can, maybe it's on that one. It's there, right? Okay, that's why. Okay, so it's because I haven't saved it. So you can see it's appeared now over here. If you don't have the Wakelet extension, you can go into Twitter, you take the URL, you copy it, and you see where the little green add is, you just paste in the web address, and it's saved in. Now I've obviously got two, I don't want to, so I'm going to get rid of that one. It's that easy to delete it. You can change the layout, so you might want to have a grid view. Again, I can go into this, and even when it's in here, I can change it here. So I could just put a double L Twitter. I can put a description and set it to either private or to public. So my collections I want other people to be able to see are public, and then done. And now it will have saved and it will appear in, fingers crossed. There you are. So it's now, it's that easy to bookmark. Honestly, that Chrome extension is just fantastic. So I think that's probably all on the Wakelet for now. Conscious of time already, knew this would happen. So this is back to a year ago. I'm not going to go through all my tweets of the last year, but oh, I feel quite emotional. This is one of the last lessons we had, and we were doing a bit of silly salsa with my second years. And then the next week, that was us. We'd got a week to go till the Easter holidays in Scotland when we went into our first lockdown. So we had a week with a weekend to prepare, as many of us did, a weekend to prepare how to do live lessons. And up above here, again, I've got all my bars of in the way. MH is mental health, health and well-being and familiarity. This was really important for us to have some kind of familiarity for staff as well as pupils, actually. So we've been long-term subscribers to Linguascope. And I know that many of us have moved to teaching language in chunks now rather than individual words. But for the pupils, you know, they know Linguascope, they can work on it individually and independently at home. It was easy for me to use on Teams when I really didn't know what I was doing at all in the start, not much further on now. So having some familiar tools is good. I think sometimes there can be the pressure, the feeling you've got to do more and you've got to do new. And actually, sometimes you just need to take a step sideways or a step back and think, but what works? You know, maybe I just need to hold back a little bit and not put so much pressure on myself. End of first week. So we're very aware, as I say, health and well-being, mental health is very important in our school with our demographic. So short survey in Teams. Yes, this extraordinary determination in the face of adversity. Absolutely. I don't know how you'd pronounce it in Finnish. So
Sarah, sorry, should we just pause a second?
Yep.
Because
okay, so we've used Microsoft quizzes a lot. Pretty much weekly. We've been using that before we went into lockdown as well. So this was at the end of the first week. This is something I just decided to do as a department. Two of the questions, it was just a short quiz. These were some of the responses. There was no way you can see from the numbers that certainly wasn't all of the pupils that we were teaching, but this was the first week we'd gone into lockdown and someone decided it was an early Easter holiday. We needed to know, we needed to have this information so that we knew what we were coming back to after Easter. So a couple of the key questions was, has the work we've set you been appropriate? And more than half the pupils who bothered responding, yes, they understood and they were able to access the work. They quite enjoyed having a choice. It's quite haphazard, the work we were setting that very first week. And then the live Teams chat, again, this was so new to our pupils. And actually what started coming out from this was that although we thought that pupils had got gadgets and smartphones and laptops, actually they hadn't. So in classes, when I talk about familiarity, we quite often end our lessons with three questions. What have you learned this week? What have you enjoyed? What have you found difficult? That sort of thing. Now, obviously there's 86 responses. These just happened to be the first ones. We did need to be a bit more specific because some of them, it was to do with science, that wasn't relevant. However, some of the things that flagged up, and this was the very first week a year ago, things that they've learned, but also about how they learn. You know, I need school to keep me on track, as well as the actual French and Spanish that we were teaching. So even in week one, they could reflect on their own learning styles. What they found difficult, again, there was some stuff to do with French and Spanish, but actually keeping on track, managing to do classwork in time. Some of the links didn't work, somebody put as well. And then what have they enjoyed? Some people actually suited the pupils working at their own speed, the tasks. Oh dear, one person didn't enjoy anything. Never mind, can't please everybody all the time. Having their own free time and their own schedule. So as we know, and we'll all be able to identify pupils who benefited from remote learning and those who have struggled with it. So using that check-in is a keep. So after the Easter holidays, we were starting with our remote learning, and the policy that we had at school was not to be actually taking the learning forward, because we were very mindful that so many of our pupils didn't have access to the internet, didn't have maybe the family background to encourage or support the pupils to be structuring their day. Just for that term, it was about reinforcing and consolidating prior learning. However, Screencast-O-Matic, I know that there are alternatives to this. This just happened to one that I started using, and I've stuck with it, and I will definitely be keeping it. So in terms of setting our remote learning, we would so easy just to click and record, didn't bother editing it. They just got the Mrs. Bell in a lockdown, you know, minus the haircut, minus the makeup, all the rest of it. But screencast short videos, the free version is only 15 minutes. So that was an advantage as well. Actually in supporting colleagues in doing walkthroughs, showing pupils how to access things within Teams. You know, you could do a short recording and then post it on Teams. But also if colleagues were struggling with doing something, I could do a short walkthrough and post it. So Screencast-O-Matic, definitely a keeper. Learning apps, and I'm very mindful of time. This is one of the first things I just wanted to show, one example task. I know there've been other webinars on this. It's taken me a few times to come back to it to actually get the hang of it. I didn't find it very user-friendly at first, but now it's just been brilliant. So a year ago, I did start experimenting again. It was, I think, from Esmeralda, did a webinar on it. I played about with it. And then I've become more and more confident as I've gone on. So, oops, hopefully up here, just get rid of that floating thing again. Okay, so hopefully up here I've got learning apps. So what I would encourage you to do if you're interested is in the Wakelet, or you can take a note of it now when you watch this back, my apps that I've created are publicly available. I would strongly encourage, because I'm only going to show one example, but if you go in and have a look, especially in that 4-5 Spanish one, you can actually see what I've created and how I use it. If you choose one, and you think, oh, I quite like the look of that, how she made it. If you actually click on create similar app, you can then go in and see the background as to how I actually put it together and how to actually build it. Okay, so that's, there's a link to it in my Wakelet. How do we actually create an app? So I'm going to show a close text because I think there've been maybe webinars on other ones. I'm not sure about this one, quite possibly. Again, I have got walkthrough videos on my Wakelet. So there's a channel or a collection in my Wakelet called Learning Apps. And it has why I love them so much. And then it has three or four little videos showing various of these. So we go on to close text, we go on to create new app. So actually, sorry, I was just going to show the five examples of ones that I've got here. So closed text, I teach, it's equivalent to kind of a year 9-10 class. It's RS4. We have NAT4, it's a bi-level class. So we have NAT4 pupils who don't sit an exam and NAT5 pupils who in a normal year would sit an exam. So learning apps is great for differentiation. So I've taken the same resource. It's got, opens up with the task, it tells them what to do. So it's a podcast that I found. I've credited it down here. It needs to be on YouTube. Okay, so you upload it via YouTube. I've taken the transcript, and because this is a more supported version, I've given the option of multiple choice. So the pupils can choose, they listen to it, and then they choose from the gap. The same source material, so the same podcast, but with a little bit more challenge. And again, you could increase the challenge by putting the instructions in Spanish. Same audio, same transcript, but this time they've got to actually type it in themselves. In the little light bulb, you can put help. So that could be a glossary. I've actually put the stress marks, the accents and so on for them to copy and paste. It does warn them that it needs to be exactly typed exactly as the answer wants it. So what I always do is when they've completed it, if it's not exactly correct, so the answer is ofrece, then they can check using a little blue marker, it goes green if they get it right. But say they put, I don't know, they did a typo or they randomly put a full stop or something, it's going to mark it as wrong. But if they take a screenshot and put it in their class notebook or email it to me, I can see, well, do you know what, you got it right, you just put a full stop there. So I was very quickly going to show how easy it is to, with one example. Oops. So closed sample, so you put your description here, so complete. Anybody who knows me knows, I'll say to the pupils, I can't talk and type, complete the gaps. Okay, so I'm going to make a supported one first. So they're going to have a choice of words. The first one I'm going to do, I'm going to put in here the text that they're going to choose from. So we're going to have Toddle's loss, and I've got my character map down here somewhere. Toddle's loss Diaz. I'm going to have Nunca Descargo. De vez en cuando. Obviously I'd have capital letters and full stops, but then we put in the closed text. So this is my source. And what I now need to do is decide where I actually want them to, what do I want them to do? So I'm gonna have them in English here. So I want them to say, I chat with my friends. So the first answer has to have this dash one dash. So the options are every day, and you have to put the correct answer has to be the first one. So every day, obviously I'd have more than this in a real one, sometimes and never. Okay, so the second one, so the second gap that I want them to fill is gonna have a number two. I never download films. Okay, so number two is going to be the same ones, but it's going to have never is going to be my first word. Then we've got to separate it. And we're going to put those. I never download films. And then sometimes I send messages. So number three, I send texts or messages. And this time I want the sometimes is the correct answer. Never and every day are going to be my other ones, my alternatives. I can put that in Spanish. I can have a background image if I want to. I could put the glossary in, so I could put every day equals de vez en cuando. Yeah, I could copy and, could copy and paste it. As you go along, you can check what it looks like. Is it doing what you want it to? Now, obviously mine is shocking, so it's got no capital letters, no full stops, but you get the idea. So if you have a look what it would look like for the pupils, I chat with my friends every day. I'm going to get this one wrong just so you can see when it corrects it. So I could be checking as I go. Okay, so that's one option. So maybe now I want to change it and I want to have it as a spoken text. Now I could, when I had that previous one with the podcast, I'd uploaded the audio and the video. What I'm actually going to do, and again, a brilliant thing about this is text speech. Now it's probably going to, this is one that I had before when I was testing it out to make sure that I could talk through it. You put it in here, I'm going to get rid of that one. I'm going to change it to be speaking in Spanish. I'm keeping everything else the same. Now, this is going to be quite challenging because they're listening to the Spanish and they've got to answer in English. So obviously you could have it all in Spanish. Let's have a look. I think I've got my settings correct. So this time they would listen to it. So they can't pause it on this one. On the podcast, they can pause it. But again, you've got the options. So it's the supported version. So the final edit that I'm going to do is now, this time they've got to write in the answers. So I'm going to leave, it's all still the same. So I could make four different exercises and just save each one with a slightly different name rather than going back in and changing it each time. Again, I would have more here, but as I say, do go in and have a look at the apps that I've already made. So this time they're listening to it, but I've got no drop down menu. I've got to type in the English every day. and then I could go back again. And if I wanted to have it as the text again and get rid of that, again, it's so quick to do. It's just wonderful. Okay, so we've got it there, this time with some capital letters. And again, they've got to type it in. So that's four ways of exploiting it just by one simple set of tasks. So I've not saved that one, but that's okay. So they can do the find the, so that's a gap fill. You can also do a find the vocab. So again, for the same class, instructions are here. I've got a text that I've put in here. This time they've got to find the Spanish for. And again, you can see, you can go on to create a similar app and you can see how I've made that up. It's the same kind of idea. And the same class, but this, that same text, this time they've got to read the text and complete the sentences in English. So this time it's a comprehension. Samuel chats to his friends, todos los días, every day. You can also use it for grammar. So I'd got one here, same kind of idea. So you could put maybe a verb paradigm or verb explanation up at the top. And then this one, I've given them the options each time as to what they're using, and they can check as they go along. So just excellent, excellent, excellent tool. Let me get rid of that floating bar again. Okay. Way behind time. That's okay. I'm not going to go over massive. I just won't show everything. Voice recording wasn't new. I'm going to come back to Vocaroo. I will show one thing using the Vocaroo in a minute. So Quicker and Vocaroo, excellent. I don't really have a preference to one over the other. I maybe use Vocaroo more only because I've just got into the habit of using it more. There's not really an advantage one over the other. So that's definitely a keeper. So easy. Literally click, it's free and it works. Virtual classroom. So obviously we all got most of us got the Bitmoji bug back in May. Well, for me, it was May. You may well have been using Bitmojis for a long time before then. So I ended up having done the department. I was the first in the school, I think, to use the Bitmojis. I found myself recreating my senior management team. I still had a job, so I was fortunate. Their offices, several members of staff, even for a leaving do, someone who is leaving from the education offices down in at headquarters. So yeah, it's a risky business once you start having great ideas. I haven't used virtual classrooms on a regular basis. Our pupils found them a wee bit tricky to use when they're using phones. A lot of our pupils don't have laptops at home or desktops at home. They're using smartphones for any kind of schoolwork. And they just found it a wee bit tricky getting into the hang of how to access it. So I've tended to use them for one-offs. So things like end of term, virtual trips around Spanish speaking world, French speaking world. Christmas, we had a for my senior pupils and it tied into a GLOW quiz. So it's not normally just a virtual classroom with links. The computer takes them to a GLOW quiz. GLOW quiz, a Microsoft Forms quiz. We tend to call them GLOW quizzes at school. We also used it for our transition project. Now, again, this is where I get a bit carried away and I forget to put myself in the shoes of the learners. So I got very excited about creating the virtual classroom. Again, familiarity. I know that a lot of virtual classrooms are beautiful. This is what my classroom looks like. It has a grey carpet and white walls. So I wanted pupils to be able to associate the virtual classroom with what they were seeing, when they actually walked into the school. That was a personal choice that I made. So they had this to explore. It took them to little videos with staff introduced themselves. There was a video of introducing the department. And it also took them to a digital escape room. Now I have to say, this was based on, again, I think it was on the webinars, showed how to use Google Forms. And I did find it quite time consuming to produce. So I haven't gone back to use that. And I think I'd forgotten that the pupils hadn't been in school. And I just assumed that they would interact with it, they'd enjoy it, they'd find it exciting. It was all in English, but it was about French and French speaking countries and Spain and Spanish speaking countries. But I think it was just a wee bit too advanced in the sense of using technology in a way that they weren't used to. So again, it's about knowing your context and using what's appropriate when it's appropriate. So dead simple idea. Scrabble. It's actually a photo of the tweet, obviously, so it's not a, a great PowerPoint presentation, but find the Scrabble set of the language that you're teaching. I give the pupils 3 minutes. This is great. Again, it's natural differentiation, if you like, differentiation by outcome. It's not necessarily the brightest pupils who score the most points. So I love playing Scrabble. It's actually sometimes, well, surprising pupils. It could be anyone who just happens to hit that word that has the highest score in letters. They can write it in their jotter. They can have a few goes at it. They can use the mini whiteboards. Just low prep, dead easy to use. Flippity. This is the last one. I'm not going to I wanted to show the Flippity board game because I know it can look a bit daunting to actually set up the Flippity board game, but it's actually very straightforward. There will be a walkthrough on, I'm sure there are other webinars as well that have got it. I'll very quickly show this.
Sarah, please do show us the board game. It doesn't matter if we run over a bit. I'm sure people would absolutely love to see it. It doesn't matter if we go over 10 minutes or whatever.
Okay.
Please do show the board game.
Okay, that's grand. These were the last two things I actually wanted to show as a walkthrough. And then the other things are literally just slides and a little bit of chat. So the manipulatives, the flippity manipulatives, again, excellent. This got quite a lot of chat on Twitter when I used it. So I'm just going to go down to here again. So Flippity is excellent, it's free. And I've used lots of these before. I would strongly encourage, actually on the PowerPoint, the next slide, I will go back to it. Recently, MFL Swavesy, Rebecca at MFL Swavesy made an excellent video about how to use the flashcards and then actually that they themselves generate a whole load of these other activities. They're not as, not user-friendly. They're not as, you can't manipulate them as much. They're a bit more restricted. Like the quiz show, I would normally make 100 pointers easy, 500 pointers more challenging. When you go via the flip cards, it makes them very, it just does them randomly. So I've used the randomizer. I'm sure lots of us use this. It's this manipulatives that I was going to use, just demonstrate very, very quickly, a very simple version of how to use this. If it opens up. So if you haven't used Flippity, there are tutorials and there have been webinars, there have been tilt webinars about how to use this. It's a Google Sheet. So I don't tend to use Google apart when I'm using Flippity. You have to rename it first of all. And what I would do straight away, just publish it to the web, then I know that I've done it and I don't need to remember it later on. Can't see, I've got things floating up here. Yes, I do want to save it. You don't touch anything that's in this top bit, in the blue bit. So I'm going to get rid of these strange bits that are already in there. It tells you what colours you can use. So I'm going to use this with Vokaroo. Okay. So I'm very simply, now you can copy from your sentence builders, you can import from Quizlet. I'm just going to do a very simple one. Excuse me, I talked to myself while I typed on Zoom. Grand maison en ville. Oops. Dans l'ouest de l'Écosse. Oops, I was going to put that on. Yeah, no, we'll have that there. And then we'll put that down there. And I'm going to have those with a blue background, doesn't matter what colour you choose, as long as it's one of the ones that's available. And then I'm going to have a similar chapitre. Dans un grand appartement en banlieue. Oops. My typing. En banlieue, that will be a l'est de l'Angleterre. Okay, and I'm going to colour these ones orange. And what you can do is, again, you can go along and see what it looks like. So you don't have to colour them. If we go here and you go to get the link here, so I've already published it to the web. If you forget to publish to the web, this bit won't work. So you can see here, pupils can sort out the sentences. I've got no listening here. It's literally just they can reorganise them as they want to. You could, so an alternative in the colour coding is if you're basing on a sentence builder, so you might want to have That bit is blue, that bit will have as orange, this bit will have as green, this bit will have as red, and this bit will have as white. And you'll see what happens, and then I'll go to using the Vocaroo with it. So get the link here, we've got that. And the brilliant thing about, I don't even need to do that, sorry, is because it's already published, it will be saving it and updating it. So you can see now, if you wanted the pupils to do it this way, you can have them sorting it in line with the sentence builder. So they've got the elements of the sentence grouped kind of by color, and then they can put the sentence together as you wish. So the icing on the cake then, and I'll need to flip back to it because I will have a terrible memory, especially when I'm being recorded, is to put a recording on. Okay, so here's Vocaroo. You literally just press play, record. J'habite dans une grande maison en ville dans l'ouest de l'Écosse. You can play it back to make sure it's recorded. So that's fine. So I'm going to copy it and I'm going to paste it in there. Now, if I'd got it how I had before, where I'd got all of that sentence in blue, so the most supported way, I would have all of these in blue. In fact, let's just do it like that. So all of those are going to be blue, and that's going to be blue. And then my orange sentence, I'm going to record the other sentence, and I'll show you how this works. J'habite dans un grand appartement en banlieue dans l'est de l'Angleterre. Again, I can check that it has recorded. If I want to, I'm just copying that, pasting it in here. Google's recognized it as a link. And if you go onto here, it will have again updated. And what we should now have, and again, you don't have to have, if you wanted to make it more challenging for your pupils, you wouldn't have any colors on the back, you have it all on white. But what pupils would have with this is they've got the support. They know that all these blue bits go with this blue recording. And you can, so I've used this in live lessons, as in via Teams. I've set this as a task and you just paste the link to them. You could put it in their class notebooks. You can link to it if you're doing, I don't know, if you're using a Genially or an escape room or something, you can put the URL and link them to this. There's all kinds of ways that you can exploit it. But how it would work for a pupil, they can see this. I tend to encourage pupils always to sort it first. Now, right, so when I was colouring my boxes, I've forgotten to put that one into orange. And then you would have this one. So it's really, really effective. And you can see how quick it is to do. And as I say, you can import from wherever you wish to import. If you're still with me, you're doing very, very well. Okay, now the board game, it's going to take a good 5 minutes. Sorry. It is very good. I've used this a few times. Again, I've set it for pupils. Again, same idea that you make. I wonder, is that the one that I'd made up? Oh, no, that one. I'm not doing a recording for this one. That's I'm going to be using in a minute. So again, we rename it. I'm going to publish it to the web straight away, and I'm going to show you what it looks like to start off with. So you can see the changes that I'm making and what it looks like in its kind of base form. And there's far more, remember, I'm trying to make these simple ideas. So there are far more complicated things that you can do with the board game, but just as a very quick fix to make it maybe suit your needs a little bit more at a kind of a base level, because that's where I am. So this is the kind of the basic level, right? So you've got these little counters that move, you've got the dice down here, and you've got one set of cards, and you've got these pictures. So let's work our way down. It already has things input for you that you can keep. So I don't want their pictures. So I'm going to get rid of the images that they've put in. I'm going to put them in with something else. Now, the moving forwards and backwards and so on, that's fine. I'm just going to copy and paste. I'm going to change a clip and I'm going to have that one. I'm actually going to change it to go back. Six spaces. I'll have another one go back, six spaces. Again, you would spend more time faffing about with these, but this one is giving you little hints and tips, but what it's at, the bit that I'm going to keep is close this window and draw a blue card, and I'll show you what that looks like. I'm going to do this a couple of times, and then I'm also going to have a green card. So you've got two card decks to start off with, but if you remember from the picture that I showed a minute ago, only the blue one has anything typed on it. So I'm going to have a green card. I'm going to set up another deck. So I tend to have one that goes, say, from French to English and one from English to French. So let's have a look at what's happened to our board game so far. So I've got rid of the pictures. I've now got some things that tell me to move forward five spaces, go back five spaces, draw a card. Let's make our card sets. So this is where we can import from Quizlet. So again, I haven't played about with these. I've only used vocab, so I'm going to delete all of that. But you can explore, and there'll be webinars that explain how you can do much, much fancier things with these cards. I happen to have one opened up here. So this is just a Quizlet set on French technology. So I'm going to export the vocab. Now you can't edit it here. I'm going to copy it. I'm going to come to my card deck and I'm going to paste values only. And as if by magic, now I can edit it. So if I wanted to add more or delete some, I've put those in there. So that's my blue card deck. There's probably a quicker way to do it, but it only takes 2 seconds. For my green card deck, I'm going to have them the other way. So I'm going to go the other language round and we'll have a look at this now because it will have saved. So the only thing that I've changed now is the card deck. So you'll see now that there's two card decks. So as the pupils move their little pieces around, and when I've used this in class, I've had two to a computer, and we could have two to a computer. When I've done it on a live lesson, it's me that moves this on my screen. We're not allowed to use breakout rooms. So this comes up, they draw a blue card. They've got to tell you what it is. Maybe they've got to read it out. You decide. You could ask them a question. It could be a grammar. It could be a picture they've got to tell you, anything you like. And then the green card is going the other way. I do quizzes. They've got to tell you what that is. It's your video quiz. So we've got that. You've still got your dice here. A couple of things that we can add in. So maybe I go back to my master here. Maybe I want to use a Bitmoji. So again, I've got the Bitmoji extension. So maybe I want to use this. It's the copy image address. So any images that you want to use, it needs to be the image address. And maybe I want a picture of me here. The one thing you have to do with this, it must end in JPEG or PNG. I don't know the reason for this, but I have to delete this off the end of this for it to show. So I'm just going to do one just for timing's sake. So that's got my Bitmoji should appear in whichever square it was. There I am up there. If it's another picture that you want to import, so I've gone to Pixabay, I've got in smartphone, and because I was playing about with this earlier. So maybe I want to have this, maybe I want to have the apps, copy image address, come back to here, find the square that you want to put it in. So let's have it in number 18. Paste it in there. It ends in JPEG, so I'm all right with that one. Let's go back and see what it's done here. So there, it's appeared down here. The final thing that I'm going to show, I don't have a title for it. Now, again, there are other ways that you can do this. The way that I have tended to do it is to go onto Google Drive and Google Drawings. I mean, I'm not planning on keeping this drawing particularly. Again, you must publish it in order to be able to, take out the trash. File, publish. There's nothing there yet, I know that. Yes, I do want to publish it, but I haven't got anything in it yet. So I'm going to insert a text box and I'm going to call it, just change the font. So we'll have that and we'll have it. I don't know, size 30, la technologie, we'll have it centered, maybe I want to, if I format the background, I don't know, yellowish, and maybe I want to have a picture. So I'm just, for the sake of speed, going to find, I don't know, smartphone. Goodness knows what it'll pick up for me. All right, well, we'll have that one with the hand. Insert it. Hopefully, there we are. So I've published it to the web. Okay, so what I need to have is, I need to have the, got it here, I want the link. Now this is a bit I'm always a wee bit hesitant with, because this is only something I've started doing recently. So this is going to be the name of my quiz. Really hoping that one works. If not, we've got all the rest of them. So let's refresh it, fingers crossed. Oh yes, hurrah. Okay, so that is how quick it is to put together. I've got all my vocab in here, one way, the other way, question, answer, picture, whatever. Move the little counters around. They can do it individually. Obviously, you'd make it look a lot more attractive than that. So that was that. And then the last little bits of these is just me whizzing through. So FlipTinet is brilliant. This is a bit where there's the link here. So MFL Swavesy had the video on how to use the flashcards. I did use it and incorporated it with classroomscreen.com. So definitely a keeper. Trapdoor, it's an old activity. I've used it for years. Lightbulb language. I can't remember what Claire called the website before, but I've been using it, her resources, for years. So that's where I first came across. There's lots of variations. But again, familiarity for the pupils, that structured support. So it allows for differentiation, but it's got that scaffolding for all pupils, because actually when they're in and out of the classrooms, they're all over the place. Flatbooks, I do love a flatbook. Right, coaching wheel. This is the last idea that I really wanted to share. And then it's literally a few more slides. These coaching wheels are something that the GTCS encourages teachers to use as part of their professional development at all stages. So I just adapted it for pupils, and we've been using them the last 2 or 3 years, and they are starting to work really, really well. So the idea of how we use them is we've adapted it. So S3, we're planning for a talking writing assessment. Partway through the unit or the term, so the midpoint, we give out these sheets and they reflect. So around the outside, I've taken the success criteria that they're going to be assessed on, which is based on curriculum for excellence document, and you can adapt it to your particular assessment. And they have to grade themselves. So they choose a colour or a pencil, and 0 is they are not at all confident, 5 is middling confident, 10 is really, really confident, or anywhere in between. And I explained to them that it's normal to have a sort of an in and out zigzag. It's very rare that everybody feels, you know, 10 out of 10 for everything, or 5 out of 5. It's normal to have a zigzag in and out. And I tend to do it on the board and demonstrate it for them. They also give me feedback on how they're feeling the level of challenges in for the lessons. Remember, I've said that we teach a very wide range of ability in our classes, how they feel the pace is, and how they feel differentiation is. And I talk to them about what I do, you know, what does differentiation mean, and what might it look like for them. I then take those back in. And then after we've done the assessment, so a few weeks later on, I give the same sheet back out. So it's already got their felt tip or their whatever on. You can't see it terribly clearly on these, because these were screenshots, but it's got 2 colours on. And when I give it out for the second time, I explain to them that ideally, we're wanting their little dot to move out the way. So maybe they've got a red dot at number 5. Maybe now that they've actually done the conversation, they feel that they're a 7. They might not. And I say it's quite all right to stay at the same level. But I'm quite a visual learner, it turns out. And for me, this is like instant. They can see so clearly whether they've made improvement or not. And it gives them such a boost, because it's them deciding for themselves. It's not me telling them. You'll see down here, yes, I'm giving them a grade. Obviously, I'm assessing their talking, their writing, and I'm giving them more formal feedback. But this is them doing their self-reflection. And we've tried all kinds of different ways. And I have to say, this is the one that we're going to be sticking with, because it's a really good foundation for a learner conversation. And it's just so immediate. And you can just change it to be, you know, talking and listening, just to talking. And they set themselves little targets, but it's very, very visual, very, very effective. Blue Kit, sure we all know about Blue Kit. Yep, totally addicted, playing about with the question styles, not just individual words, but I've been playing about with doing gap fills, how we can support students. And quite often I'll make two different forms of a game, one that's more supported, one that's less supported. Again, really easy to generate a Blue Kit from a Quizlet set. And again, it encourages me to think about an existing resource. So again, I've used Quizlet for years. How do I actually exploit that in these new times? How can I maximize it? You know, was I making the same kind of Quizlet sets? How can I make something a bit more interesting? So you'll be relieved to know we're nearly at the current day. New year, new lockdown, new tools. Version two, well, some things never change. So those of you in Scotland, we were actually given the benefit the first 3-4 days of term in January. We had to kind of get ourselves prepared, like that was all it was going to take. But anyway, that first Monday back, oh my goodness, Teams just crashed. I don't know if it's in England as well, but it was just a disaster. Nothing was working. I was getting hundreds of posts from the pupils saying, where's our work? This doesn't work. Can't get onto this. This doesn't work. I couldn't get anything to work. It was utterly horrendous. I'd also got a member of staff absent again. It was just horrific. End of week one, and some of you, if you follow me on Twitter, you'll have seen that I've shared these. I was getting so fed up. What are we doing today? And to be honest, you know, 3 months in, we still get asked. That's like, oh my goodness. And I got to the point where I just couldn't cope with the number of questions that we were getting. You know, the video doesn't play. I can't open the assignment. So obviously hindsight's a wonderful thing. Made a little screencast-o-matic video. And again, put this post on. So this actually got posted on all of the teams so that pupils could refer back to this. But I actually walked them through. Yeah, we'd assumed, again, that they had made progress. And they hadn't. They were all over the place. They'd got an awful lot to deal with. Accents. So again, trying to encourage accents or use of accents, trying to encourage, which we do in class anyway. But when they're using a pencil, we can remind them more easily. When they're using their gadgets, yeah, they get a bit lazy with it. They start writing in text speak. And this generated a lot of chat on Twitter again about all the hundreds of variations of ways that you can insert accents. And certainly myself, I'm sitting here, I'm using my daughter's computer, new computer for laptop for this presentation. I'm looking at our old family Mac, which is ancient, has no webcam. And obviously Mac controls are different. And I had been using an old laptop of my daughter's, which has the separate number pad to the side, so I can do the alt codes. But I also have a school laptop we were given, which is lovely, but doesn't run Zoom and has lots of firewalls in it and has a different set. So I can't predict what the pupils are using at home. So in summary, our lockdown, and apologies for the formatting on this slide. Our lockdown, what did it look like? We followed our regular timetable. We were doing a combination of synchronous and asynchronous lessons, but new learning was to take place mainly through pre-records because we couldn't guarantee that pupils were able to join live lessons for a whole host of reasons. They had got better technology at home now. There was a huge drive across the authority and some charities to provide laptops and so on for families in need and Wi-Fi dongles and so on. The head teacher wanted us to have consistency across classes in each department. So we had a sort of a format, still each teacher, the three of us could deliver as we wished. But as I mentioned, we had a member of staff absent. So again, for me, having a format really helped. S1 to 3, which is year 7 to 9, had one live lesson a week. So that was one lesson where we would actually do a video lesson on Teams. And the pupils' cameras this time were enabled. They tended not to. They could unmute, whereas previously they hadn't been able to. And we had more of a senior phase. And the way that we ran the lessons was that we had a weekly assignment via Teams, and it tended to be a video lesson using Screencast-O-Matic, a retrieval grid because the pupils were familiar with that, and sort of sentence builder and those activities that go along with the EPI approach, which worked very well on the videos, and a quiz that consolidated the learning. The other two lessons a week, we were just sort of checking in. So the pupils were doing the work and we just do a register at the start, but we weren't actually speaking to them, but we were online if they needed us. What went well? I've mentioned better provision of ICT this time. We were more familiar with Teams to some extent. Remote learning really suited some of our pupils, and there were some surprises. You know, ones who it's too cool to be good at languages or interested, they actually really shone. They were handing in work, they'd got supportive parents, and that was lovely to see. So we made a real deal of sending out the praise postcards. MFL Twitterati, I've already said, and it's just amazing. The time that people have given to put on the webinars, organised obviously by people like Helen and Joe, Linguascope have put ones on as well. There are others, the number of teachers who've given their time, but teachers who've just been making and sharing the walkthroughs, the wee how-tos, the I found this, why don't you try? It's just been phenomenal. It's been the most incredible year of CPD. However, the flip side of that is to accept that sometimes you just can't do it all. I've mentioned, Department of 2.6. Well, if one of you full-time members of staff is off, it just leaves Muggins here to do it. And I had to accept that actually I couldn't do everything that I wanted to all the time. Yes, I get addicted. I get, that magpie in me that wants to get all the sparkly bits off Twitter, and I just couldn't. Even better if I found that we were having to firefight ICT issues retrospectively. So I was having to do things and answer people's queries when I think that ideally it should have been done at kind of an authority level in advance. To be fair, we had put on a couple of years ago a parental event, but that was back in the days before we really were using, well, we weren't using Zoom, and we expected parents to come in. Well, many of our parents, it takes two or three buses to get into us. They've got childcare issues. We'd got a parental evening event where we were showing how to use phones and Word and Microsoft and so on their phones. And we just didn't get the take up because it was too difficult for them to come into school. Fast forward 2 years, obviously we can do all of this via Zoom now. It would be better if we had more engagement from pupils with the work and live lessons. I know that some schools, they get 100% attendance at live lessons, 100% return of work. We don't, and we have to live with that. We've tried lots of different, we've tried different approaches, but some of our harder to reach pupils have been even harder to reach. And that is no reflection on our guidance staff. Our pastoral staff have been superb. They put in a huge amount of time checking in with the pupils and following up and encouraging them. What I am aware of is that when we go back to real lessons in a week's time, that the gap within my classes will have widened because some of them have not done any work or engaged at all since December. Okay, when they're in your class, you can peer over them and give them a tap on the shoulder and a wee nudge and a wee prompt, a bit harder online. So I mentioned having a format worked. I think it would work anyway, but actually in times of absence, absolutely. So these are just two slides of how it might look. We are very, very nearly there. So this is 2 year groups, two different languages as you can see, but a similar structure to a live lesson. Okay, and all it meant was that I was using a similar kind of template, similar kind of activities. So obviously I was having to input different language, but I knew that it worked. I knew it filled the time. I knew it was effective. So the wee one that's highlighted up here, you've got four texts in the language. So in Spanish, I would use it to read it aloud. So they're being exposed to it that way. Maybe find the Spanish four, maybe some comprehension. And they were using the chat boxes. They very quickly, the novelty of unmuting themselves wore off, and it was very difficult to get the lower school, the S1 to S3, to actually unmute themselves, and they were using the chat. But that was really effective, having this kind of template. Shared PowerPoint, Jane Basnett is responsible for bringing this idea to me. Again, there are webinars on this, but again, as I've said here, my bi-level Nat 4, Nat 5 class, I could set two different tasks. They could be working on them separately, so it's a tenses gap fill. So my Nat 5s, they were working on their own PowerPoint, a shared PowerPoint that was live, and they were filling that in, and the Nat 4s had a different kind of gap fill that wasn't grammar based. At this point, I wasn't using Class Notebook. I'd just not had the time, having had the staff absent before Christmas and then again in the new year. I just hadn't had the time to get to grips with it. I have now become much more familiar with it, so I'm using it a lot more, which is great. Online Splat, same idea, shared PowerPoint. You have sentences either in the target language or in English. You either read them aloud in English or you read them in the target language, and you've got two pupils working on each PowerPoint. So as and when they were able to get onto the shared PowerPoint, you share the link in the chat. This was during a live lesson. I haven't tried it in person yet. But you would allocate them to a slide. You say, right, Bill and Joe, you head to slide one, right? I can see that, I don't know, Samantha and Tamsin, you're online, you head to slide two. You have to tell them how to get to the highlighter tool. And again, you're trying to predict what kind of gadget they're using. It doesn't work on phones is a real downside. And again, a lot of our pupils were still using phones for their home learning. So this doesn't work on phones, or it didn't when I was using it. So that kind of ruled out some people, but they really enjoyed it. It worked really, really well. So that was a nice thing to have for them. So that's a keeper. Microsoft quizzes, I'm not going to go into now, but they're brilliant. We used, again, Greenshaw Trust, can't thank them enough for putting on all those videos. Many of them tied into topics that we were doing anyway and were presented very similar in a very similar way to how we would have taught them. So we would use those, and they started with the low stakes quiz using Microsoft quiz. We'd been doing retrieval grids just on a grid on a PowerPoint. So the pupils got used to using these. So I will be using that more. Again, I think it was Jane Basnett and various webinars showed about using the ranking. There was Gloria Enrique as well a couple of weeks ago who reinforced this about the ranking style of questions. So that was new to me. It's actually Jane that I came across it first. So you type in the words in the question and then you put in the options and they slide them up or down. So you can use it to reconstitute a sentence or for verbs. That's very good. And like it, again, this was new to me. So here it's actually numbers. So they've got sums, the two French numbers, and then what does it make up? I also used it for chandeleur in French, had a video and they'd got to work out the ingredients. So I've got the French ingredients down here and the English translations, and they just have to click one dot per row. Now, obviously you get some of them that go down in a lovely diagonal line. You never know, they might get one of them right. So MS quizzes, definite keeper. ThingLink. They're saved in my Wakelet, but love ThingLink, very effective for careers information for our S3 making their options, very, very easy to link things in, really effective. So ThingLink, if you haven't looked at it, I say in my Wakelet, there are three or four examples, used it for S1s as well. On Francophonie, we always do Francophonie at the beginning of when they learn French, and we do Spanish speaking world at the beginning of them learning Spanish. So again, we had an interactive thing link that took them to all kinds of videos and information about French speaking countries, and there's some of the language apps again on Francophonie. Okay, last two slides, I think. If anyone's still awake and with me, can't even see the gallery, thankfully. So this was from the Teach Me MFL icons a few weeks ago. The do less well, easier said than done. But I think a lot of us, since we're thinking about coming back into schools, have been reviewing about the content and our style of actual teaching. This I wish had come about a year ago. So DigiLearn Scotland had a webinar, which was great. But these questions about, you know, is the learning suitable for online delivery? Is it better for the classroom? We were having to think about this a lot. So these are really, really helpful prompts, especially if we have to return to some form of blended learning. But as I say, I wish we'd had this a year ago. And then the last thing, we've put out a questionnaire to S1 to S3, looking for their views on our current course. Some of the constructive feedback, these pupils, they're putting so much thought. Yeah, one of them said, yeah, I don't like this, not meaning to be rude. Yeah, it's really lovely the way they're actually thinking about this. It is, yeah, flagging up some quite interesting things. They don't like the topics that we've put in, fashion and holidays so far, they don't want to do. It's like, oh, okay, well, we'll put those in because we thought they'd be more interesting for you. But anyway, so I've still got to plow through. Well, that's a job for next week. Okay, last one. Things that I'm going to be keeping. Learning apps, absolutely. Flippity, absolutely. MS quizzes, definitely. Wakelet, yes. ThingLink, class notebook, shared PowerPoint activities and screencast-o-matic videos. So these were things that were new to me or have been new to me over the last year. Things that I need to look into a little bit more, still need to fully exploit class notebook. Classroom screen, I've used a couple of times, I need to look into it. Spiral, I've used a couple of times. Again, I need to look into it actually in the classroom. Genially, you'll see in my Wakelet, I have made some and shared some activities, but I need to get to grips with it and I'll be signing up to the webinar in the week. Virtual classrooms, again, it's just how do I use them or make the best use of them. Escape rooms, same again, just I find them time consuming for what I actually get back from them or the amount of time it takes the pupils to complete them, and then the EPI kind of Conti approach. So thank you so much. I did overrun dramatically, so sorry. My contact details are there. The Wakelet, will take you to that one. I think actually takes you to the specific tilt one. I need to add to it. It's got some of the resources in there, but I do need to finish off just adding one or two bits to it. So thank you so, so much for your patience, for listening. Obviously, any question, I'm well aware that people probably desperately need to go and get maybe a nice cold drink of something rather than a cup of tea at this point, but happy to answer any questions. And just thank you so much for all you do, Joe and Helen, and for giving me the opportunity to share a few ideas. And as I said in my tweet, if there's just one thing that you take away from this, yeah, just one simple idea, that'd be great. Okay, so thank you very much.
Wow. Absolutely brilliant, Sarah. Superb. Thank you so much for, first of all, talking about the context. I thought that was incredibly important. I loved your down-to-earth honesty as well about talking about everything, the way in which you've learned so much from the community as well, how you were talking about that, and then all those practical ideas in context again. And you've taught us some new things, certainly the board games idea. I'm sure there's going to be lots of people who are going to be making board games in the next, you know, few weeks or so, and I'm sure sharing them as well. That was absolutely brilliant. And yeah, all the other tips and tricks you shared are wonderful stuff. Really, really wonderful. Thank you so much, Sarah. It's awesome. Helen, any thoughts?
Yes, and you'll see the comments. I don't know whether you've got the chat open at the moment, Sarah. You can see all the comments flooding in, and there've been lovely positive comments throughout. And Sandrine particularly saying, this is true. I mean, your department is very lucky to have you. I mean, you know, when you were talking about the things which people like, what helps your job, and it's having managers, isn't it? It's having people who do what you're doing. So just brilliant that you've got these ideas, plus it's obviously being shared with your school and now with us. So thank you so much. And I've allowed everybody to open up their webcams and, you know, audio if you want to as well, because I'd love to be able to just capture a picture. You've had great numbers of people who've been here. I mean, obviously some people have had to leave, but we did say to you, please go on. We wanted you to go on.
Absolutely.
So you did exactly the right thing. So it'd be lovely to see you all. Thank you to Jerome there, and Adeline have been doing all of the behind the scenes help as well. So
Marie.
Okay, so I'll just take, for those people, if you could just put in your picture.
We do have some questions, but we'll do the class photo first, and then the questions.
Yes, so because I know that people will have to go. So we've got the whole of Rafana. That's great. We need to see you. There's Sheena as well. Lovely to see you. So great. So shall I take a little picture now? And Joe, you haven't got your hat on. Didn't recognise you.
My hat. Oh, you mean? Oh, no, yeah. Sorry, no, Joe, I could do a virtual. Oh, I see. Oh, sorry. Another. Sorry.
Right. Let me. Okay.
Another joke.
Here goes. So I'll do one, two. I'll do two of them because normally someone's got their eyes shut. So here goes. One, two, three. There we are. There's one. And actually, I think it was all right, but I will still do another one in case.
Just in case. And
one, two, three. Mind you, I look a bit of a mess, but still. There we go. I think that was everybody. Because oh no, we've got number two as well.
Right. And again.
One, two, three. And that is Helen's there in the top left. And Linda and Peter there. And again, one, two, three. There. Great. I might put that on the web page. So over to that was lovely, but clearly Joe has got there's some burning questions.
Well, we've got four questions. So shouldn't take long, I'm sure. So first of all, is there a template of, oh yeah, so in relation to the Microsoft forms that you shared, and there's no obligation to do this, but the question was, is there a template of these forms for Pupil Voice? Would you be happy to share those once you've sort of taken off like the school details, et cetera?
No, it's fine, because all you do is you do the share as a duplicate, and then they have to duplicate. There's nothing that's confidential to school on it, because okay. It's literally just, there's nothing on it. So that's absolutely fine. So on the Wakelet, there's one that's kind of a combination of all my favourite styles of questions that are taken from actual quizzes that I've done with classes. So it's completely random. You know, it's a bit of Spanish, it's okay. A bit of French. It's not on the same topic. But yeah, absolutely. I'll put on for the feedback, the Pupil Voice, and I can share the one that I've just got open at the moment about the feedback on our courses. Absolutely.
Amazing. So have you shared the Wakelet link with us already?
It's on the two PowerPoints. So it's on the first PowerPoint and on the last PowerPoint.
Yeah, fantastic.
And I'll put it in. It's on my Invercad, on my Twitter feed as well. And I will put it in a tweet later on as well.
Superb. Lovely. That's excellent. Thank you. So, and then the second question is, This is more of a wider question. In your opinion, what's the difference between wakelet and padlet? I know they're quite similar, but which is your sort of go-to one?
Yeah, I used to use Padlet a few years ago, and then I think they changed it and you could only have like so many Padlets. Again, yeah. It's the standard thing. You can only have so many that are free, and then you have to start deleting them. And it was a shame because we used it with our partner school. We had an e-twinning partner school, and then we had to stop using it because, again, funds are just tight. And I know a number of teachers who do pay out their own pocket, and there are some things I do pay for, but you've got to make a call at some point. You can't subscribe to everything. So at the moment, Wakelet is free and it's fabulous.
So that's why
I use Wakelet. I haven't used it with pupils yet. I know that there are lots, I think it's probably American, a lot of people do use it with their pupils, and the pupils upload and contribute things. I haven't got to that stage yet. It's purely for me curating things and sharing things. But that's why I use Wakelet.
Yeah, lovely.
Could I just interrupt there and say, because one of the ideas, and you may have been coming on to this, was that we absolutely loved the flippity board game. It reminded me that I did make one back in August and then forgot about it. And whether or not you were to collect those. So there's a discussion, Padlet or Wakelet. But from what you're saying there, probably Wakelet would that be the better way of collecting it?
Yeah, so what I've started doing is putting... I struggle with Google Drive a little bit, but what I will be doing is putting the links, because again, I just click on that Wakelet extension, it just automatically saves it onto it's so quick. Padlet, as far as I'm aware, I'm not sure because I don't use it anymore. I don't know if it has that function to have an extension and just zap, that's it saved. But I will be collecting. So I've not made many of the flippity board games. And again, the randomized or any of the Google Sheets, they're also specific to your own context and the combinations of vocab that you want to teach. But that's one of the things that I'd wanted to do before today and just didn't get around to doing because there's a lot of them. But yeah, they will be on the Wakelet.
Fantastic. I mean, just in relation to having contributors to a Wakelet, you can... generate a code. If you click on the share option, you generate a code, and then we could then share that code out.
So Helen, you were thinking in terms of like the MFL Twitterati.
Because Jerome is sort of king of Wakelet.
And I think Jane got something as well. She got one that was like a collaborative
I think one would have to be careful on who you share the code with, though. You wouldn't want to put the code out publicly, I think. Yeah, so from that point, well, we can have a think about that, but certainly there's been a few people who've done Padlets that people have then been able to then publish on it, etc. But
My Wakelet is only a view only. People can't, at the moment, they can't contribute. It's not a shared collection. Right. It's you can view it, you can access it, you can download any of the collections, but you can't add to any of them.
Perhaps we need a Wakelet of Wakelets. So you have a Wakelet for collecting people's Wakelets group links.
You could indeed.
Because I do see that sometimes, you know, part of this is curating it so that you can go and access it and you can find it. Understand.
Yep.
Fantastic. So if it's okay, question three, we have the question, do your students all use a PC or tablet or mobile in the lesson? So you were talking about the ICT suite. Are the students allowed to use their own device as well?
So I know it's a bit of a hot potato on Twitter at the moment. We have 13 computers in each of our classrooms. Normally 10 or 11 of them work at any one time. Obviously I teach classes of 30, 31. So it sounds like I'm really picky. First world problems and all that. But if I've got a class of 31, 13 isn't enough even for half of them to go on and half of them not to go on. So as a school, we do have a policy that phones should be off and away unless the teacher allows you to. So no, we do encourage pupils to use the phones as and when it's appropriate. So they're not using them all the way through the lesson, but something like a blue kit, honestly, the computers take so long to log on and then you find out it's not working. The pupils get very frustrated. So when we're back in school, we'll be looking at how best we actually utilize them. I don't like pupils having to look at a very small screen, maybe it's just because I've got terrible eyesight. But to be doing their work on a little screen, we don't use them through the lesson. So I know there are some teachers would be using class notebook through a lesson or other platforms. We don't do that. It tends to be for one-off quick things like go on and do this quiz, go on and do this blue kit, go on and do this, like the shared PowerPoint. That's what I'm saying. I need to look at how I would use it in a class, because I have got each of the three classrooms has got these 13 computers, but it's how best we use that. So it'd be half of them would be doing that, and then half of them would be doing a different task, and then maybe switching. But again, at the moment, we can't be using computers, and we can't be using switching computers.
Yeah, it's all about adapting to your own context and working out what works and what's feasible. Brilliant.
And the rules in Scotland are a little bit different.
We had somebody though from Scotland giving us a really good webinar where they had just invested in tablets for everybody, hadn't they?
Linda McLean, who was with us, I think she's gone now.
But I mean, I was just wondering, Linda, if you're in an area where there is deprivation, sometimes there are funds. Well, yeah, I'm assuming
that was Linda.
So we've been talking about this. I saw on Twitter that Edinburgh just investing in like 39,000 tablets or something for pupils or iPads.
That's right.
But also the concern is, so although lots of our pupils, and we have, it's been hundreds of computers given out across Greenock, is they're at pupils' homes. We cannot have pupils transporting them in and out of school. Right. And we've had laptops in the school before on like the charging trolleys. But again, they're not looked after. They go, it's just, we don't have enough for them. There's just not the budget for them. But it's something that obviously needs to be looked at.
Fantastic. Okay, we've got just the last question, just a technical question, which was in the board game that you were showing us, you had the little eye on each square. What happens if you click on the eye?
Sorry, right, I should have made that clear. I should have clicked on one. So anytime there's an I, it takes you to a message. So on those ones, it was the things like go forward 5 spaces, go back 6 spaces, take a blue card, so it's some kind of instruction. So the alternative to that, instead of having the little I, is that in the Google drawing or elsewhere, you create a drawing that says go forward 3 spaces, but they would actually be able to see that all the time they were playing the game. Whereas if you've got it in the little I button, it's a little element of surprise for them. So they don't know, do they want to land on that square? Is it a good thing or a bad thing? So that's all that's behind the little I.
Okay, that's lovely. I love the way you use Google Drawings in that way, the way that you published it first and then you then adapted the drawing. And then, that was really clever.
Again, there might be an alternative. It's just some of the other ones, it's a bit hit and miss. That one I found more reliable.
Yeah, that's so that would work with any image, wouldn't it? You'd be able to take an image, as obviously copyright free. I would recommend a website like photosforclass.com is really nice for finding copyright free images, as well as places like Unsplash and Pixabay. You just put it to Google Drawings because it obviously has to be hosted somewhere. You publish it on the web and then put the link in.
That's the thing. I don't think I actually said it in all my rambling, was when you're using the image and you can't save it just to Google Drive. That's the other thing. Although it needs a URL, it can't be within Google Drive itself. I don't know why Google Drawings is different, but it doesn't accept it within Google Drive. So you can't just save a picture to your Google Drive and then paste in the link. It's got to be through the Google Drawings.
That's a great tip. Thank you so much.
It is really good because that was the thing which I just wasted so much time trying to work out how to do it. So, that's really helpful. Thank you so much.
Lovely. Well, it's been a fantastic way to spend a Saturday afternoon. Just brilliant. I knew you'd be brilliant, Sarah. You know, it took a bit of persuading, but we got there, didn't we? And it's thank goodness that we did. And thank you so much. And it's still recording. People will be able to watch back the webinar. Brilliant, brilliant practical tips. And really useful as well about your context and other people, I'm sure, in Scotland, wherever it might be in the world, who have, are in a similar context, I'm sure will draw much inspiration for what you're sharing here. So thank you so much for your time and the effort of putting the presentation together. Thank you.
And there's Helen about to get on her bike and about it all. Look at that.
There we are. We got Jo saying she's going to do a board game this afternoon. And what's left of the afternoon? It's just been lovely.
I think brilliant. Because whenever people mention games, we all love it, don't we? I mean, as language teachers, we like games. We like Scrabble. We like that sort of thing. I think we do need to have a nice games night or something. One Saturday, perhaps, where people made up their games. We could play.
That's a nice idea. But again, it's finding the balance between the amount of time it takes to put something together and how long the pupils are actually going to spend. Because I could spend an hour making a fabulous escape room and the pupils solve it in 5 minutes. It's like, well... whose time are we using here?
I admit.
So I enjoy it, but it's not really a sensible use of my time.
Yeah, I spent ages and ages doing an escape room using notebook, and I'd like to be able to say that it was really worth it because I put so much time into it. But in the end, it was meant to be for a whole year group and about 20 did it. They enjoyed it. They did like it, but it had taken me hours to do.
But you can see like that flippity board game, literally, I mean, 5-10 minutes, and especially importing from Quizlet, boom, it's done.
Yeah.
Very, very quick.
And you're a big fan of Word Wall as well, Sarah, aren't you?
Yep. So again, it's one of those ones where you can only create five. Yeah. And again, Textivate. Yeah, that came up. It's something that I've been using for a long, long time, Textivate. And I can't name check all the fabulous. Yeah, we have a subscription. So I have a personal, well, paid for by school, but it's an individual subscription because my colleagues don't use it as much. I really like Textivate. Wordwall, again, on the free account, you can only create five resources. You can access lots of other ones, but Wordwall is brilliant. And again, you'll have seen it in some of the little clips of the tweets and so on. But there's so much out there. And that's why, as Helen said, it's nice to actually revisit some of the old things that you've done or the previous things.
Because
there's another one and another one. It's like, but I quite like that one. Let's go back and try that one.
Yeah.
It's just the same with in-class tools as well.
I mean, one of the things I like about something like Textivate, and sometimes it's the ones where you pay, is where it is this idea where you do one thing and it creates loads of other things.
Yep.
And where it very easily lets you import, because almost I'm often trying to avoid anything where I just have to type into the thing itself. I want to make it that I can click and do as you showed. You've already got, if you've got a table, if you've got, whether that's in Word, whether it's in Excel, just highlight and paste it and it goes in.
And that's why learning apps is so brilliant, because you can copy and you can't import, but you can copy and paste.
Yeah.
And so many possibilities with all the different options of audio or text to speech or...
Can I just, I mean, one thing that I did notice, of course, when you were doing the learning apps, you were showing how you could do the alternatives, the options. That did require input, didn't it? Or is there a way of...
You can't import it. So I could have, if I'd got... I just couldn't be bothered, to be honest. If I'd got a Word document open, I could have copied and pasted. So say I'd got a vocab sheet or a sentence builder, I could have just copied and pasted the vocab in, or I could have, if it's a text, so I wouldn't normally, when I was doing in the text, I wouldn't normally type it all. I'd normally have a worksheet and I'd copy all of the block of text and paste it in. Okay.
Yes.
And then I would have to write my sentences and, you know, make the little closes. But again, it's just because I only wanted to do very short bits.
Yeah, I suppose that's what I was thinking. With the closes, you were having to type it in, whereas presumably with the Textivate one, you can have it there and then you can select which bits
it tells you, you know, use a defined gap or whatever. So no, in because again, it's giving you the ownership of where do you want the gap to be. It doesn't, it's not random, it is user defined in language app, language apps.
We just had the question from Giselle about the Scrabble tiles. Where did you find those, or did you make that yourself, or how did that
work? No, that's just a search for a Google image.
Okay,
a search online, just type in, you know, Spanish Scrabble tiles. It's actually very, very difficult to find them, but again, because if you're a Scrabble fan, you'll know that each language has different combinations of letters and the more widely used letters and so on. Obviously with the Spanish one, you've got the accents. So no, it was just a long Google search to find it.
Because I put a link into what I thought was, because I'd searched for French, I thought it was, and then I looked at it and I thought, actually it isn't, it's just the English one. But if you, there's a whole Wikipedia page which tells you for every single language how many, what the distribution is and what they're worth. But really we're looking for, aren't we, a nice image like you had.
Yeah.
So perhaps that's something we can just do a bit of research on and just have a shared, you know, there you are. Someone's done the long search and there it is for you. It's a great idea. Right, shall I stop recording this then?
Good idea. Great stuff.
You've given us right to the end. We've had this conversation. We've really made you work this afternoon, haven't we?
Thank you. Thank you for your patience.
No, it's been lovely. It's been